Hi everyone, we are live from the garden tonight. It's a beautiful summer evening, probably about 85, 90 degrees out, nice and warm. And tonight we're going to talk about some watering tips for your summer garden. We just did a little 2-minute video a few days ago, and we've had some questions about summer watering, how to beat the heat, how to keep your plants alive in the hot sun. I don't know about you guys, but it seems like it's been an extra hot summer this year. So normally we don't get this hot until maybe August, September, October, but man, the summer is starting off with a bang, and we got hot right away in June and July, and it doesn't look like it's cooling down. Yes. Hi everyone, I see some people joining us now, and a lot of people are saying extra hot, little bean, extra hot where you live. Hi Amanda, how are you doing? We're talking about summer watering tips tonight, and we were just discussing how this summer seems like it is extra hot. So, hot in the hundreds. Hello world, how are you? Oh my goodness, I hope it cools down for you soon. Hopefully your garden is staying alive and staying hydrated. Hello Brianna, how are you? And Super Weight God, nice to see you. Super Weird God, sorry about that, nice to see you. What? Chile is having snowstorms? Oh my goodness, I can't believe that. Okay, so it seems like it's hot all over the country right now. And some people were asking, Hardcore Gardener just got done watering, and that's a great time to water Hardcore Gardener. Actually, I was going to talk about that, is some people were asking about the time of day to water, whether it's better to water in the morning or in the evening. And I did mention that in my little tip video I did the other day. And hopefully you guys are enjoying the Cali Kim 2-minute tip videos, and we're having a lot of fun filming them. Nice, quick, short, and to the point. So please let me know if you have any other tip videos that you'd like to see, and we'll try and get those in there. But people are asking about watering in the morning versus watering in the evening. What's the best time of day to water? Well, first of all, you definitely don't want to water in the middle of the afternoon when it's super hot and there's a lot more water evaporation going on. Some people were asking about watering in the evening as far as concerns about powdery mildew and diseases and things like that. And that's one reason why it's super important to water at the base of your plants and not water at the leaves. So if you water in the evening, even if you water at the base, the leaves aren't going to get wet. The water will just soak down into the roots. Now, usually powdery mildew and blight and other kinds of fungal diseases occur when the leaves get wet and stay wet. So hopefully by watering at the base, it will help avoid that. Now, if you're in an area that's very prone to powdery mildew, which is pretty much any area that has super high humidity, or if you get a lot of rain, the leaves get wet and they stay wet, you probably have seen some powdery mildew already going on your, especially your squash, your cucumbers. And if you live in one of those areas where you have a lot of it going through your garden, then you probably do want to stick to watering in the morning as much as possible. That way, if the leaves do get wet and things splash up on the leaves, the water splashes up on the leaves, it has plenty of time to dry before the end of the day. And that way it helps avoid some of those diseases. So someone was asking, why water at the base? Because when it rains, the rain doesn't just rain at the base of the plants. And that's, of course, very true. But as I mentioned, powdery mildew happens when the leaves get wet and stay wet. So as much as we can control that, we want to try and water at the base. So obviously you can't control the rain, but usually if you live in a rainy area, you have a lot more of a problem with diseases and powdery mildew on your plants. So hopefully that helps answer your questions. If you have more questions about that, pop a question in the chat there, and let me head over to the chat and see if we have any questions so far, and then I'll go back and just talk about some questions that were asked on the comments. A lot of people are saying that it's super, super hot, raining a lot in Florida, Mari. So I'm wondering, Mari, if you're having a lot of problems with powdery mildew on your plants, since you know, you have a lot of rain there. I know Florida is a super high humidity area. And have you found anything particular that works for powdery mildew if you have it going on in your garden? Someone asked a question here, Matthew. Can you grow carrots, lettuce, and radishes in the heat? If I put a shade cloth on them, and also any ideas on a DIY shade cloth? Matthew, that's a great question, because actually right behind me here, I do have some lettuce growing in the heat. as I mentioned, been really hot in the 90s and the hundreds, and I'm actually growing lettuce here in a veggie pot. It has a shade cover. This cover folds down like this and keeps the plants shaded, it blocks 17% of the sun's rays. And this thing is a self-watering container. Absolutely going bonkers with the lettuce. I mean, look at this lettuce. Doesn't that look beautiful? I mean, I've never been able to grow lettuce like this in the heat of the summer. I am just absolutely floored at how this thing is performing. So you can definitely check out the videos on that. I just did 3 videos on the veggie pod, including a veggie pod harvest video. So go back and check those out. But you can also do like a DIY shade cover, which will really help your cool weather vegetables or your lettuce and things like that. Although I did have some lettuce growing. You can see over there, there's camera guy on the chat, our dog Mac. Everyone say hi to camera guy and Mac. And you can see there, I do have a DIY shade cover covering one of my garden beds. And you can definitely do that. I got that shade cloth on Amazon. So I will put a link for that when I upload this video to YouTube. So you can take a look at that if you're interested. But interestingly enough, my lettuce under that shade cloth has already bolted or is in the process of bolting. But the lettuce in the veggie pod is still growing very, very nicely. Now I did have a little bit of the lettuce in the veggie pod that bolted. Let's see. It gets a little bit more sun. Actually took it out today and planted some green beans back in here. It was just starting to bolt and I went ahead and harvested it and got some green beans, but I also planted some dill seeds that are popping up right there. I don't know if you can see the little tiny seedlings, but dill is typically very difficult to grow in the summertime as well. So the veggie pod is really keeping the heat out and allowing the cool weather vegetables to grow. So I'm pretty excited about that. Okay, let's see. Let me go back to a question here that I got on comments, and then we will come back to the chat in just a moment. Some people were asking how much to water. Is there a certain amount you should water your plants? A gallon a week, a half gallon a week? And my answer to that is it really depends on a couple of different things. First of all, it depends on the weather, and it really depends on the type of soil that you have, which is something I didn't have a chance to mention in the 2-minute tip video. But if you have a really heavy clay soil, it's gonna hold on to the water a lot longer. If you have a sandy soil, the water's gonna drain right through, and you'll probably need to water a little more often. With clay soil, you'll need to water less often. And if you have a loamy soil, which is the kind of soil we all would love to have, which is really the perfect soil, you're gonna be somewhere in the middle. So check your soil, see what type of soil it is. A clay soil will hold together in a ball when you squeeze it. It won't, release. It'll be really heavy, heavy soil. And sand, of course, will kind of just run right through your fingers. And the loamy soil is, if you think of compost, I mean, really that's kind of a loamy mix, really the perfect consistency of soil, lots of organic matter, and will hold on to the water very, very well. Now, if it's very hot where you live, you're obviously gonna have to water more often. When you get in the 90s, the 100s, you really want to head out and check your plants every day and just make sure, look for signs that your plants need water. Now, wilting is not necessarily always a sign that you should run out right away and water your plants. Some plants wilt naturally in the heat of the day, like cucumbers, like squash, and then they perk up again in the cool of the evening. Watermelon also do that. Now, if they're not perking up again in the evening and you're checking the soil and seeing it's very dry, then by all means, water your plants. But if they perk up again in the evening, then they're probably just fine. But I always say just make sure you check your soil. Now, I'll show you right here. I've got some peppers that are looking a little bit droopy. It was very hot today and these did not get watered last night. My drip irrigation is running tonight. So you can see they're really looking like they need some water. So that's kind of a good gauge, is just to check your plants and see how they look. But just take a little walk through your garden, at least once a day, and check and see how things are going. Okay, let's see if I have any more questions here in the chat. Arab has a question. I'm in Canada Zone 3, way up north there, and there's about 50 days left in my growing season. What can I plant right now? so that I get to harvest it? That is a great question. And I actually have a free growing guide called Grow 3 Vegetables in 6 Weeks that would be perfect for you to check out. It's on my website, CallieKimGardeningHome.com. You can get it free. And basically it talks about some quick vegetables to grow are beans, lettuce, and peas. And I'm sure up in Canada there, you're probably still getting, or you probably have, you know, kind of cooler days, much cooler days than we have here. So you can definitely get a harvest, like lettuce and peas are cool weather vegetables. So you could definitely get a harvest of those probably within 50 days or so. And beans need a little bit warmer weather. So you might want to put those in an area of your garden where you're getting lots of bright sun. Most likely you can get a harvest of those in 50 to 60 days as well. So give those three a try and make sure you come back and let me know how they did. Hello World has a question. Let me see if I can find that. Oh, my cucumber is not producing anymore. What is happening? The plant is very healthy. Hello World, that's a great question. And a lot of times when it gets very hot, and I think I remember you saying that it was very hot where you live, the plants just kind of quit. I mean, they don't die, but hopefully they don't die, but they just quit producing as much because they're putting all of their energy into just staying alive. So if it's super hot where you live, you might see some blossoms kind of dry up and drop off, and you probably won't have as much production out of your plants. You might want to try a shade cloth, like I mentioned. Veggie pods are working great. I actually just planted some cucumbers in here today, some little seedlings that I already had going. The other thing you can do is make sure that your plants are well fertilized. The worm tea is a great organic fertilizer you can use. Vermistera worm tea really helps the plant stay healthy, stay disease-free. And when your plants are healthy and disease-free, they're going to be able to handle the heat stress pretty well. They might take a little break from production, but as soon as it cools down, things should pick up again for you. So hopefully that'll help you out. Okay, Cal Garden. From Fresno, my peppers and chilies flower and then just dies. Why? I'm assuming that you're talking about your pepper and chili flowers. And if you're in Fresno, Fresno is cooking right now, I'm sure. Just like we are here in Southern California, but I'm sure even hotter. So it's probably just heat stress. A lot of times the blossoms will dry up and drop off in the heat. So I'm pretty sure that might be what's happening. So just keep your plants hydrated, well watered, and if you can, give them a little bit of shade. Hopefully that'll help. Okay, let's see, too hot in Fresno, hardcore gardener. I wonder if you're a little bit cooler up there in NorCal. I believe you're in higher elevation, so pop something in the chat there and let us know how your garden's doing. Yes, the question was, can you use a bed sheet for a shade cloth? Absolutely. Now you're not gonna get a lot of sunlight through that. It will diffuse it somewhat, especially if it's like a white bed sheet. Will diffuse the sun somewhat, but it will pretty much block out most of the sun. So the shade cloth that I have over there is a 40% block. So what that means is it blocks out 40% of the sun's rays, but does still allow some to get through. So ideally that's what you want. You don't want to completely block the sun, you know, unless it's an emergency plant situation and you just completely want to block it out because your plant is dying or in complete heat stress. But try and get something that will just block it out for a little bit. And I saw that Rich said it's 95, hardcore gardener up there in NorCal. Wow, so you're cooking too. Rod, welcome. Baja is humid 89, but the peppers are loving it. Yeah, I bet they do. I bet they are. Great to have you on here, Rod. Okay, Doyle Piper's question. I have small ants in my garden bed. Should I worry? Well, ants on their own don't cause too many problems that I've had anyway, but the problem with ants is a lot of times they bring in the aphids. And the aphids are definitely something you don't want to have in your garden. So if I were you, I would try and get rid of the ants if you can. I've used before a little ant trap made from borax and sugar. Mix a little bit of water in there, make it a little paste, and put it in some kind of a plastic lid, like a sour cream container lid or something like that. You can set those little DIY ant traps around your garden. The ants will be attracted to it, and that'll help get rid of them because the borax kills them. So give that a try and let me know how it goes. Okay, so let me see here if I had any other questions. I think that was the majority of the questions that I had in the comments. So let me see what other questions are over here in the chat. And if you guys have questions about watering, about dealing with heat, please go ahead and ask those, and I'll scroll through and answer as many of them as I can. Richard Bushy is asking, how often should I use compost tea for the vegetables? You can pretty much use as much compost tea as you want, and that would be another great thing that you could use during the heat to give your plants a little bit of a boost. You could also spread compost around the base of your plants and water it in to give them a little bit of a summer boost. But the compost tea is great because it's a real gentle fertilizer, super easy to make. You can use an aerator and get fancy if you want to, or you can just let some compost kind of sit in a bucket of water for about 24 hours. I've got a video on how to make compost tea. And then you do want to apply it right away because it's not aerated, so you don't want the compost tea going anaerobic on you and going bad and having all the bad bacteria develop in there. So if you do mix up some compost tea, put it on your plants, use it right away. And it should help give your plants a little bit of a boost. Okay, Ben, have you tried Revive RX by MI Gardener for stressed plants? Yes, I have. I've actually been trialing it in my garden for about a week now. And so far, it's looking great. I mean, it's still a little bit soon to see results, but I am definitely seeing some new growth on the plants that I put it on. And actually, what I've been doing, and I think it's a great combination, is combining the Revive RX by MI Gardener and the Vermistera Worm Tea. So that way, you're getting the Revive RX has a really good high nitrogen, gives it a good nitrogen boost. The Vermistera Worm Tea has all the beneficial bacteria and microbes that will really help your plants be healthy and productive. And by the way, a little side note on the Vermistera Worm Tea is, it's a good idea to use that as a foliar spray to help prevent against powdery mildew. Now, it's not going to kill powdery mildew, but what it does is it coats the leaves with a kind of a protective coating. The bacteria, the beneficial bacteria microbes multiply on the leaves of your plants, gives them that good protective coating, so it really does help crowd out the pests and disease. So give that a try, and I am going to be doing a video on that probably in the next couple of weeks. Okay, a question here, Cole, about a pumpkin. Pumpkins, wow, can you believe fall is just around the corner? So hopefully your pumpkins, if you're growing pumpkins, are in full swing too. Your pumpkins are getting eaten alive, and I want to know how to save the vine and create more roots on it. Okay, well, Cole, the best thing you can do, or the first thing you can do, is try and find out what is eating your pumpkins. And I'm assuming you mean the leaves are getting holes in them, or is it the actual pumpkins themselves that are getting eaten? That would be important to know. If it's the pumpkins themselves, you may have some kind of a critter, a rat, or something that's invading your garden. If it's bugs on the leaves, most likely it's some kind of a chewing or sucking insect, and you might, okay, on the leaves, he says. So you might want to try the neem oil. Does work well for that. So you could do a neem oil, even throw some worm tea in there and spray your plants down. You want to do that every 2 to 3 days because that does interrupt the life cycle of the bugs. And try and spray in the morning, in the early morning, or again in the evening when the bees are gone. That way you don't disturb the bees. And actually the morning is probably better to spray that because you're going to give the leaves a chance to dry before the evening hits. Okay, let's see. Do you grow Lori? Hi, Lori. Nice to have you on here. Do you grow stevia, and do you know if it's okay to spray with neem oil? I have never grown stevia. That would be a fun one to try. And I am pretty sure it's okay to spray with neem oil. I've sprayed neem oil all over my whole garden, and it's worked out just fine. So I would give that a go, and hopefully that'll work out well for you. Okay, drip irrigation, good for groundnuts. I don't know about groundnuts, but drip irrigation I use all over my garden, and it's actually an absolutely fantastic way to water. That's my preferred method, not only because I have such a large garden, but it slowly drips out to the base of the plants. It's going to go way down into the roots, and that's really the best way to water. Those roots really need that deep soaking, and that's what's really going to help your plants not get heat stress during those hot summer days. So if there's any way possible, you can install a drip irrigation system in your garden, even if you just have one raised bed. They're so easy to install. I did a couple videos on that, on how to install it in containers, how to install it in your garden. The Dig drip irrigation system is the one that I absolutely love. It's very inexpensive. A raised bed kit, I think, costs around $30. You can also put a timer with it, so that it completely takes the guesswork out of it. You don't even have to worry about it. You just set it and forget it. And then, of course, you want to go around and check your plants and make sure that, you know, kind of trial and error, if your soil is getting enough water. But I'll pop some links when I upload this video on that kit, because it really is a good kit. Okay. Katie, let's see here. Katie. Hi, Katie. I have smart pots in my hard in your yard. Okay. I was wondering what the best way to water peppers and tomatoes are. Spray the bag itself? I have drip irrigation installed in all my smart pots, but if you don't have that, then yes, you definitely want to take your nozzle or your watering can here and just water down deep into those smart pots. Make sure that you get plenty of water in there. Make sure it's draining out the bottom, and that that soil is really, really getting soaked. Now, something that's been very helpful for me, and it might be something you might want to consider picking up, is a moisture meter, because you can poke it down in the smart pots or in your garden bed soil and see how wet your soil is, even like up to a foot down. So you really want your plants to be good and soaked up to about a foot down underneath the soil, because that's where the roots are and that's where they're going to get the most nutrients and be able to take the water up. So anyway, hopefully that answered your question about the smart pots. Okay, have you ever used, Marissa, have you ever used soap nut liquid on your plants to remove bugs or as compost? No, I never have. I don't really know what that is. So maybe you can explain a little bit more about that. I've never heard of that. Let's see here. Anything else? Any other questions? Hardcore gardener is starting some kale and brassica in about 2 weeks. Rich, that's a great idea, because you know what? Fall, believe it or not, is just around the corner. So if you, it's a good idea to get seeds started for fall even. A lot of people start getting cool in September. So you can get your fall vegetables, your cool weather vegetables, your brassicas like broccoli and cauliflower started now. You can start your seeds indoors in that way in about 6 weeks. When September hits and hopefully the weather cools off, you will have transplants to put in your garden and not just seeds. So it'll give you a little bit of a jump on the fall season. Lisa, great question. What can we plant now in SoCal? You could plant just about anything, really. I am actually going to be doing a series on a second round of warm weather vegetables. Really excited about this series. Going to be a lot of fun. I'm actually going to be doing some All-America Selection variety winners, which are plants that, and seeds that are bred for high production. So we're going to be starting that probably in the next couple of weeks. But basically, you could do beans right now. You could do peppers. I would do maybe some smaller varieties of tomatoes, like some cherry tomatoes. You could do some kale, some greens. Like I have greens right behind me if you have some kind of a shade cover for them, or if you have a veggie pod. Watermelon, if you start watermelon right now in SoCal, you're going to want to do more compact varieties, because you just don't have enough of those long summer days left in the season to get the big varieties of watermelon. So basically, look at your climate, see when your weather kind of shifts and changes to cool weather, and then take a look at the plant you want to grow, and then kind of count backwards. Like beans take about 6 weeks. So if your weather gets cold and you get a frost in October, November, you've got plenty of time to plant beans. So just take a look at the back of those seed packs, take a look at your weather, your first frost date, and kind of gauge from there, if that makes sense. And maybe we'll have to do a video on that, because that could probably use a more in-depth explanation. Okay, here, guys, let's see. Minnesota, Gardening Zone 4B. Hi, Doyle. Is there anything that you have a challenge growing? Okay, let me think here. I actually, yeah, the past couple of years, I have had a challenge growing large size watermelon. And in fact, I have another garden bed where I've planted some, and for some reason, they have just kind of stalled out this season, and I can't quite figure out why. So I'm definitely working on it. It's a garden bed right over here. I'll have to show you that maybe on a video. But actually, there's some squash growing over there, but my watermelon, my large variety watermelon, are just kind of puttering along. So I'm a little bit puzzled, trying to figure out why. So hopefully we can figure that out and they will take off for me. Okay, Nicholas, when should I start my seeds indoors? I'm in Florida zone 9B. Okay, so for indoor growing in Florida, you can start seeds indoors pretty much anytime. I'm sure in Florida, similar to me, you can grow year round. So I actually just started some seeds indoors myself about 3 weeks ago, and I am now planting those out in my garden, some cucumbers, some squash, a second round of just about everything. I've got some marigolds and zinnias. Just moved those outside today to harden them off, and I'll be planting them over the next couple of weeks. So in Florida, anytime, anytime. Okay, any more questions here?
Matt had a question.
Matt.
I start my lettuce and peas now in small pots in zone 8. It is around 90 degrees.
Lettuce and peas in small pots in zone 8. 90 degrees is a little bit warm for lettuce and peas. They probably won't germinate too well unless you have something like a veggie pod or even in shade cloth outdoors in the garden, they're probably not going to do too well. What you could do is start them inside, and then in about a month or so, they'll be ready to move outdoors. So put them under some grow lights indoors, move them outside. Probably your weather most likely will cool off in about a month. Okay, Mumbai Balcony Gardener, I see, is on. Hello, nice to have you on here. Great to see you. If it's okay to go off topic, of course. Kim, how's your midnight snack tomato doing? I actually am not growing a midnight snack. I believe that is Gary. I think he's growing that, Gary Polarchik at the Rusted Garden. So that I do not have. I've got some Kellogg's Breakfast tomatoes going in Mumbai Balcony Garden. I know that you absolutely love those too. I have a couple on the vine. I have not been able to pick any yet. I was a little bit late getting those started this year, but I actually have some in a smart pots over on my deck off here to the right of me. And I'm actually hoping to do a container gardening tomato video in the next couple of weeks. And that plant will be in that video. So be watching out for that. Okay, Lori, I love that all YouTube gardeners talk and share information. Yeah, so it's a lot of fun. We do try and collaborate a lot with each other, myself and Gary and Luke over at MI Gardener. And some other YouTube gardeners, and it's a lot of fun to get new ideas and just to get all the information out there to you guys. So speaking of Gary at the Rusted Garden, the Facebook group Gardening Coast to Coast, if you have not been over there lately or have not joined that, make sure you get over there. It is so much fun. There is just so much sharing going on over there. Post photos of your garden. It's really fun. Get a lot of tips. People are talking about, you know, heat tips. What are you growing in your area? What are you harvesting in your area? And I mean, the posts fly by so fast, but it's a great place to make some friends with other gardeners all across the country and even locally in your area. I mean, every post is tagged by gardening zone, so you can search the tags and then find people that are growing in your area and have tips that are specific to your area. So I see a couple people in there have already joined over there and are having a great time. So yeah, make sure that you head over there and check it out. It's Gardening Coast to Coast over on Facebook. Okay, Little Bean Garden, check out on Facebook, Gardening Coast to Coast. Just search Gardening Coast to Coast and you will find it. And by the way, it's Gardening Coast and then the number 2 and then Coast. And the reason why we named it that is because Gary's in Maryland on the East Coast, I'm on the West Coast. So kind of covers everything in between. And if you're not in the U.S., you can still join, no problem. We'd love to hear about your garden as well. Okay, let's see here. Any other questions? I've never grown moonflowers, Joey. Is there anything you can make with a crookneck squash? Yes. Oh, crookneck squash is so good. Actually, I'm not growing any, but my friend Mary Jo, who was on the $10 Garden Series the first year we did it, is growing a ton, and she brought me some. And my favorite way to prepare vegetables for my garden is to just chop them up, mix them up in a bowl with a little bit of olive oil, salt and pepper, pick all the fresh herbs I can find in my garden, all the different varieties, chop those up, salt and pepper, throw it all in together, and then you can either put it on the grill, like one of those grill pans, Or you can lay it out on a big sheet pan and just roast it in your oven for about 10 minutes and then broil it for a couple of minutes. And it is so, so good. In fact, I just made some, we're going to have it as soon as the live stream is over, some zucchini sticks and little eggplant sticks. Olive oil, Parmesan cheese, and herbs, broil them, and oh my gosh, they are absolutely to die for. And be watching for an eggplant harvest video coming very soon. So, okay, hopefully that helps. Get your summer veggies in however you possibly can. We're eating from the garden every single day. We've got this beautiful lettuce back here that we've been eating for lunch. Been sending beautiful garden fresh salads to camp with camera guy to work. Camera guy, are you liking your garden fresh salads? Yes, thumbs up, he says. We throw in tomatoes, cucumbers, maybe some black beans, some chicken. And I've been making a homemade ranch dressing out of homemade yogurt and herbs. Absolutely gorgeous. Yes, Mary Jo, Choices Gaming. If you guys would like to see a live stream at Mary Jo's garden, because her garden is going bonkers, let me know, because we got to go over and see her garden. She is just going crazy with the squash, the tomatoes, the herbs, absolutely everything. So I think we're going to have to get over to her house again.
Alyssa wants to know if she can start watermelon seeds now.
Alyssa, okay, in SoCal. Okay, Alyssa, if I were you, I would just start some compact varieties of watermelon now. Probably a little late to do the big watermelon, but you could try like a Sugar Baby, you could try a Blacktail Mountain. You should have plenty of time left in the growing season still to get a couple of small harvests. You also might want to try some cantaloupe. I know Baker Creek Seed has a green machine that's absolutely to die for. I wish I would have planted some this year. You might want to give those a try. Those are smaller and absolutely wonderful. Okay, I am growing, hello world, I'm growing Brandywine tomatoes, and they're taking a long time to turn red. Why is that? You just got to be patient when you garden. They will turn red, but sometimes it just takes a while. So patience, I know you're dying to have those absolutely beautiful tomatoes, but it will happen. Rod, hello Rod, is your habanero still growing? Yes, in fact, I probably forgot to label it. I'm not sure exactly which plant it is, but it's on my hot pepper side of the garden bed. I'll have to do a little live stream on peppers and kind of show you guys around my pepper garden bed. So maybe in the next few weeks, we'll fit that in. Have you ever grown Lemon Boy tomatoes? Any tips? I do have, I'm pretty sure it's a Lemon Boy growing this year. And I've gotten a few tomatoes off of it, but it's unfortunately it's in an area that's getting a little bit shaded, so it doesn't have a ton. I believe I've gotten one tomato and it was absolutely delicious, and I'm sure if I put it in a sunnier spot it would probably do much better. But so far it seems to be a very hardy plant and growing in spite of the shade that it's in. Okay, Lori, oh, this is a good question, Lori Hillard. What does it mean when my bell peppers have a large area that has a thin brown area? Does anyone have an idea? Yes, Lori, that basically it means that your pepper is getting sun scorched. It's just getting scorched and a little bit burned by the hot sun. So that happens to me all the time. It just kind of thins out. And what you can do is when you cut that pepper open, just cut that part off and the rest of the pepper is still perfectly good to eat. So what you might want to try doing next year is planting your peppers close together so they kind of touch each other and help shade each other out. So that definitely does sometimes seem to help in my garden. Okay, we are gonna take about two or three more questions and then we'll sign off for the night. There's a question here, can squash be grown indoors? I don't know, I've never tried it, I'm sure it could. It would probably take quite a bit of space. So experiment. Don't be afraid to experiment in the garden, indoors or outdoors, and then make sure you come back and let me know how it did for you. Okay. The name of our dog is Mac. M-A-C. Mac. And he is a great dog, very mild-mannered, and likes to join me out here quite a bit and get on the videos too. And he pretty much, for the most part, stays out of the garden. Okay, any more watering questions? Oh, I see a good question. Yep, sun scorch does happen. Rich commented on that. Pack them in tight to help shade them out. Thank you, Rich. Matthew, my tomatoes are in pots and turning yellow. Okay, what you want to do is, number one, make sure you're not overwatering them. That could be a sign of overwatering. Also, make sure if you're growing in containers, you are fertilizing at least once a week. The containers really need that feeding because the nutrients and the water just drain right out. So don't overwater. Check for water. Fertilize at least once a week. And when you do get yellow spots or yellow leaves or branches on your tomatoes, clip them off so it doesn't spread throughout the rest of your plant. I had one up on my deck today that was looking pretty shabby. Once I trimmed it up, it looked fine. And then all the energy can go into growing new leaves and producing more tomatoes. Okay, we'll take one last question here. My zucchini only has male flowers. That's a great question. Could this be too much water? No, Thomas, that's really not a sign of too much water. Just be patient. Usually the male flowers do pop out first. And sometimes they drop off, so don't be alarmed if they start falling off. But just be patient. The female flowers should come along within a few days or a week or so. Again, with the hot weather, things just kind of do tend to slow down. Once you do see those female flowers, if you're not getting some good growth of zucchini, you can go ahead and hand pollinate. And I have a couple videos on that, so you can go back and check those out if you want to know how they did that, how to do that. Okay, guys, thank you guys so much for joining me out here. It was really a lot of fun to hang out together, talk to you a little bit, and find out all your watering questions. And I really appreciate you joining me here. Camera guy is going to come over and say goodbye. We really appreciate you guys. We appreciate you watching. Have a great night, and we will see you next time. Bye-bye.